I suppose by now you've seen this sketch of a generic pipe with a constant flow rate passing through it. I hope you aren't too bored with this sketch because I want to use it again to discuss how you apply the law of conservation of energy to a water system. You see, if energy is conserved in a closed system, then the energy at point one is equal to the energy at point two. Continuing with the assumption that water is flowing from one to two, then we need to account for the energy losses as H of L, and we add it to the residual energy that is left over at point two. From your first physics class, you learned that energy has two parts, potential energy and kinetic energy. So we rewrite the generic equation here to include both terms on each side of the equation and include the energy loss on the right side. Kinetic energy is often introduced as 1/2 mass times velocity squared. Accounting for the properties of the fluid, we can convert this computation into length units using velocity squared over 2g. There is a really good reason to convert energy into a unit length that I'll explain later. Next, potential energy is defined as mass times gravity times the height of the column of fluid acting on a point. This expression can also be converted to just the elevation in meters or feet. And that is where the conversation about energy conservation usually stops in a typical physics course. Kinetic energy is velocity, and potential energy is elevation. I'm here to tell you there is more to potential energy than elevation. Take, for example, the situation where you have an elevated water tank. And I'm sure you've seen these somewhere in your town or maybe even attached to your house. And next to the tank is a house that is connected to the tank with a pipe. So long as the house is not using water, there is no flow and therefore no kinetic energy. At the same time, the house is not as high up as the tank. What this means is that some of the potential energy is no longer elevation, but is now converted to pressure energy, and this is potential energy too. This simple discovery was one of the main contributions of Daniel Bernoulli's paper on the conservation of energy equation. Pressure is equal to the height of the fluid or depth times the density times gravity. We can substitute in gamma as the unit weight of the fluid, then rewrite this equation to solve for the depth, so that the result has length units of meters or feet. So even if the fluid isn't moving between the tank and the house, we still have two parts to the potential energy in the system, the elevation and the pressure. Moving back to our original sketch, we can represent the elevation as a distance above the datum plus the pressure, or what we call the pressure head, which is measured from the center line of the pipe upwards, plus the velocity head, or V squared over 2g, which extends up above the pressure head. This is the reason why we convert all of the energy units into lengths, so that we can visualize the result and easily add or subtract them as needed to complete our analysis. Finally, we write the right-hand side of the equation with the similar energy components at point two. From this sketch, we can see the energy lost in the pipeline as simply the difference in energy between points one and two. The blue dotted line is the hydraulic grade line, or HGL, and represents the rate of energy loss in the system. Another way of thinking about the hydraulic grade line is if a hole is poked in the top of the pipeline, then water will squirt out of the pipe up to this height, assuming there are no energy losses as the squirting water exits the top of the pipe. The red dotted line is known as the energy grade line. If you were to insert a tube that taps into the velocity of the fluid in the middle of the pipeline, then the water will rise up to the level of the EGL line. The HGL and EGL are always parallel and always decreasing in the direction of flow. This is because energy is always being lost for a system due to friction. so it is always decreasing. The only time you will ever see the HGL and EGL increase in a pipeline is because energy is being added to the system, say, for example, by using a pump. While it might be interesting to think about how high the water will squirt if there is a pipe rupture, we mainly use conservation of energy as a tool to help us find the pressure at any point in a system. In other words, we are often solving this equation for the pressure at point two. I will develop this process further in the next video.